This is the story of a millennium of monarchs. It begins with William I in 1066, the most famous date in British history. It goes on today with the Golden Jubilee of Elizabeth II. These are the great characters of the island's history, the men and women holding center stage at its greatest events. They've brought plunder, conquest, murder, religious hatred, and sexual intrigue. And over these thousand years, a huge change has taken place. The transfer of power from one ruling monarch to all the people. But one thing has never changed: the extraordinary lives of the kings and queens. Saturday, October the 14th, 1066. The sun sets on a desolate English battlefield. The Battle of Hastings is over. Harold the King is dead, the Saxon army defeated. William the Conqueror glories in victory. Another country has been added to his Norman kingdom.
3 months later, William was crowned King of England. There were other equally violent men poised to seize that inheritance. But it was William, supremely ruthless, who triumphed. And it was William who would change the course of British history for centuries to come.
The man who conquered England at Hastings had come a long way from his humble origins across the Channel in France. In autumn of the year 1028, in the town of Falaise in Normandy, a local girl gave birth to an illegitimate son. The red-headed boy was christened Guillaume, William. And up until the age of seven, his childhood was, as we would say, uneventful. All that changed when his father was revealed to be none other than Robert the Magnificent, Duke of Normandy. Throughout his rule, Robert battled against Norman nobles determined to seize his power. On his death, he outwitted them by leaving everything to William, his unknown son. Aged seven, William, the boy Duke, was plunged into conspiracy and intrigue.
His life was in constant danger. His tutor was killed while he was out riding. His steward was murdered in the very bedroom where William himself slept. This violence, so close to home, would have a profound effect upon the young Duke. Who could he trust? Anyone might be a potential traitor or an assassin.
In 1052, William married. Now 23, he was tall and tough, with close-cropped hair. His child bride was Matilda, granddaughter of the King of France. She was gentle and obedient. It was said that William used to drag her around by her hair. Even so, she bore him 9 children. Marriage into a grand French family brought William land, power, and connections. But it did nothing to settle Normandy's rebellious barons.
They still thought of William as an upstart, and they didn't approve of the new power he'd gained by his alliance with Matilda. Within months, they'd risen up against him. But William was ready for them. Those early assassination attempts, they taught him the one big lesson of his life, which was to meet force with force.
So William fought back. The medieval historian, Guillaume de Poitiers, describes how, swiftly, efficiently, he defeated the rebels.
William, chief of the avenging host, was undismayed by the sight of their swords. Hurling himself upon his enemies, he terrified them with slaughter. Most of them perished in the rough ground. Some met their death on the field of battle, crushed or trampled by those who fled. Many of the horsemen with their mounts were drowned in the River Orne.
William's defeated opponent signed an oath of allegiance to him here at Caen. Now, anyone else might have settled down for a comfortable married life, but not William. His obscure origins, or his continuing reputation as William the Bastard, had made him a man with something to prove, a man hungry for more power and more territory. The main chance of that came not here in France, but from across the Channel in England.
In 1051, word reached Normandy that Edward the Confessor, the Saxon King of England, had chosen William to succeed him, should he have no sons of his own. This was not as surprising as it sounds. The two courts saw much of each other and were related by marriage. But William had a rival. He was Edward's brother-in-law, Harold Godwinson, a man just as tough as William, and the eldest son of England's most powerful and feared family, the Godwins. The story of plot and counterplot which followed is told scene by scene in the Bayeux Tapestry, 200 feet of embroidered linen cloth later commissioned by William.